episode 3191, Fighting the Unseen Battles.
It's time to train for life and love your journey. In this episode of Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie, you'll learn new ways to rediscover, rejuvenate, and renew your mind, body, and spirit. Please welcome your host, certified life coach, personal trainer, and nutritionist, Christiane Wargo. Staring at a stop sign,
watching people drive. Happy, happy day. I hope you're enjoying some good food and football. Oh, yes, it's the weekend, so how can we not enjoy football? You know, I'm all about it, but really what I'm all about is your relationship with your sweetheart. Yes, it's relationship builders, fighting the unseen battles. For those of you who are brand new to Create Your Now, welcome to this incredible family. I'm so delighted of your presence. If you already haven't had the opportunity, you'll want to head on over to createyournow.com where you can learn more and sign up for the K.I.S.S. newsletter, the Keep It Simple strategy, everyday solutions to live, love, and impact. Well, this episode is brought to you by AIM, inspiring connection and community. You know, conflicts can frequently unfold behind closed doors within the sacred confines of our homes, where love is meant to flourish. But even though you might be fighting the unseen battles, your marriage can thrive. But I know in the moment, it might seem like that SEC, you know, football game, that it's like the rivals and they're just like all at it. And if you like football, you know what I mean. We don't need to have those kind of rivalries within the privacy of our own four walls. But I know it can get really, really tense, can't it? And so in that, I want you to think about it because, you know, these untamed conflicts can silently erode the foundation of your marriage. And that's what a lot of people don't understand. The fights, the arguments, the disagreements, if they're not done in a healthy manner, it's pile upon pile upon pile upon pile. And eventually that gets the nooks and crannies of your heart where maybe you've been hurt before and it begins to erode. And it forms like a cavity. And that cavity fills up with things over time. And it's like you create this negative bank account within your heart. If you're one who keeps score, like, oh, yeah, my hubby didn't do this. He hasn't finished this, like, in, I don't know, the last two decades, Christiane. You're keeping score. You've got to let that part go in order to move forward. But it's hard because you're dealing with two imperfect human beings, right? Two people who are coming together, living their own lives, and now they have to create something together. They're living a life together. They want to have an adventure together. And it's great when you're dating because everybody is trying to say, oh, I'm so good for you. And you really put on your best behavior. I know I did it. We all did it. And then we get comfortable. We say, I do. And a little bit at a time, the onion layer is peeled back. And in that peeling back of that, we reveal our true colors. Now, some of our true colors are beautiful and they're vibrant and they're gorgeous. But other times, well, they're a little bit frosty in a negative way. You know, like it's been spoiled a little bit too much. And then your spouse is like, I didn't see that coming. And all of a sudden now there's tension. Tension that you didn't really think would ever happen, but because now you're your true, genuine self, now you're letting it all hang out. Well, if partners were to commit together, your spouses coming together, not just based on vows, but would say, you know what? We really need to lead with kindness and compassion. We need to do something together. Yeah, we may not always agree, but even in our disagreements, even in the fiercest storms, we can still rise above the challenges and nurture a healthy and fulfilling marriage. You can do that, but you got to commit to action. That is your KISS to Keep It Simple strategy. Commit to action. And the problem is that's where we fall short. In all honesty, what happens is we get too busy. We're wearing all these badges. We're wearing all these different hats. We're running the kids in, you know, 3,000 different directions. You've got your football games, your soccer games right now. Basketball season is soon to begin. Tryouts will be around the corner. You're finishing up volleyball. I mean, it's just one thing after another. You're coming out of, you know, long distance running, right, for your track. And then eventually you're going to end up doing something else here in the spring into summer. And it's like you can't catch what you can't catch. The world is moving too fast. Your schedule is bombarded. And for you to even think, oh, Yeah, I kind of need to look at this differently, but I really don't have time for it. I got to just move on. And so you just make do and you just keep stuffing it down and stuffing it down and stuffing it down. And what do you think is happening in those nooks and crannies where the cavities are building? It's eroding. And eventually what happens? A piece of your heart breaks off. Not literally, right? We're talking figuratively here. But you become so hurt. And then you're like, well, you know what? I guess that's it. And all of a sudden, you just can't stand to live with each other because you don't see eye to eye. And because you don't see eye to eye, you're like, I'm done. And it's easier to go in, figure out a way to divorce, separate the things, and just split your separate ways. But then you forget about the ripple effect of what those actions have. Now, I'm not saying that divorce is not a valid action. I'm not saying that. So please hear me. If you're a person who's gotten divorced, I'm not saying I'm against that, okay? What I'm saying is that when we're looking at our communication within our four walls, we get really laid back. We let all the bad and all the good hang out, but usually it's more bad because we give away our good. That's just part of it, right? We'll give more to a stranger than we will to our spouse. Think about that. Are you giving your spouse just your leftovers? Or are you giving your spouse the first, right? Hot off the plate. I made lasagna last night for my daughter and son-in-law. You know, I'm down here. I'm traveling. We are waiting for a baby and the baby has not come yet. Anyway, it's a long story, but we won't go into that. And so I decided I would make something that would stick to her ribs and maybe induce a little bit of labor. It hasn't worked yet. But regardless, it's like a lasagna, right? You layer it after layer after layer after layer. And it just, it's all this stuff. And when you cook it, oh, it just all soaks in. Okay, that's the goodness of it. But your goodness can also create badness. Yeah, I know that made a lot of sense, didn't it, grammatically? But we'll just go with it. That lasagna that I made could actually be a negative. What if I put in there spoiled meat and spoiled cheese? What if I put in ricotta cheese that was just like, I don't know, it began to sour. And then you had all of that stuff cooking. Now I'm sitting here and lasagna doesn't sound very good at all, does it? I hope you're not having that for dinner, by the way. But anyway, lasagna is great. I love it. And so, you know, it just kind of melds together, but then you take a bite of it and all of a sudden you're making this horrible face because what you put into it has now simmered in and now it's baked into everything. The noodles, right? It works into everything. You've got to be careful because that's what's happening. These unforeseen battles that you have within your marriage that are kind of quiet that you don't think anybody knows about, which honestly we all have. Okay, we just have them to different degrees and we deal with them differently. And so here I'm saying, instead of letting those types of bad encounters really threaten your foundation within your marriage, you got to commit to action. You've got to take control now as to your attitude, your tone, how you're loving and who you're loving. Because sometimes we love the wrong thing. Sometimes it's not the who, it's the what. It's more of, I've got to do all this, so you're loving your career more than you're loving your husband. Whatever it is, maybe you're putting your children over your husband. Now, yes, I know there are times that you're going to have those seasons that your kids need you and you're right there all the time. You still have to find time for each other, right? You can't lose that intimacy of growing together. So you got to commit to action. And when you're looking at kindness and compassion, when you're fighting the unseen battles, you got to practice empathy. And the first step towards fostering a kind and compassionate environment within your marriage is to do just that. Practice empathy. Empathy allows you to see the world through your partner's eyes, to understand their perspective and to validate their emotions without judgment. You know, when disagreements arise, take a moment to pause and genuinely listen to what your spouse is saying before you respond. Don't try to finish their sentence. Now, I know I am very good at finishing my husband's sentences. In fact, I probably actually use better vocabulary than he does. No, not really. He uses more challenging words and I have to sit there and go, how do you spell that? But I can finish them and I'm already like 10 steps ahead of him. But I have to let him finish his sentences. I can't do it for him because therefore I'm not listening to him. And then what happens? He feels unheard and he feels like I'm walking all over him. And what he has to say has no valid reason to be listened to, and he feels less than. And what do you think he's thinking about in those nooks and crannies of his heart? I'm not good enough for her. You don't want to put your spouse on the defensive side of your marriage. So when disagreements arise, take a moment to pause and genuinely listen to your spouse. Before you respond, seek to understand their feelings and needs and approach the conversation with sensitivity and respect. Like look at Proverbs 18:13, right? It reminds you to answer before listening. That is folly and shame. Don't jump the gun, so to speak. Practice empathy. Number two, choose words wisely. Words wield immense power in shaping our relationships, especially our marriages. And the way we choose to express ourselves during heated moments can either heal or harm. What was your last conversation with your spouse? Was it a conversation that just brought you together and it was healing, it was sweet? There was this, you know, beautiful, refined intimacy between the two of you. And I'm not talking about SCX. That's not what I'm talking about here on intimacy, okay? Now, yeah, that can be an after effect of great conversation and really coming together. Or was it harmful? Were you negative? Were you threatening in the way you approached the conversation? When arguments arise, refrain from personal attacks or resorting to hurtful language. You need to own your own emotions and feelings. Don't try to say, you put me in this position. You did this. You. No, say, I am feeling this. And in this position, this is where I'm hurting. Now, if your spouse is expressing their hurt and their tenderness, then you need to listen to that. So strive to communicate your thoughts and concerns in a calm and constructive manner. Right? Go back to those I statements and really foster a more open dialogue. Don't sit here and say, you either need to do this or you need to do that. I'm telling you, ultimatums do not work. And remember Ephesians 4, verse 29, let no corrupting talk come out of your mouths, but only such as is good for building up, as fits the occasion, that it may give grace to those who hear. So you have to choose your words wisely. It's not about just saying, oh, whatever you feel. Because in all honesty, that's laziness. That's taking the low, easy road. Well, you know, I'm just kind of mad at you right now. So I'm just going to hammer it to you because that's how I'm feeling. Okay, go beat on a punching bag, but not your spouse. Choose your words wisely. And finally, number three, practice forgiveness. Forgiveness is vital. It's a vital component of any lasting marriage, right? It allows you to let go of past hurts and heal wounds and move forward together, right? It's not about just patching up something within your heart, right? Let's go back to those nooks and crannies. It's not just about saying, okay, we're just going to fill this with, oh, you're so sweet. Oh, thanks, babe. And then you get flowers. Oh, that's so sweet. All of a sudden, you're kind of feeling warm and fuzzy. But then 2 weeks later, something happened and now you're just right back at it again. And it's like you ripped that Band-Aid off, you know, the part where you put the Band-Aid on, there's a lot of hair. Do you remember that? When you were just really, really young, now you might be used to it, or maybe you have less hair. It doesn't hurt as bad. But when you were younger, man, you pull it off and you would scream. I can remember my kids, Mom, don't do it, right? We don't want to feel the ripping of the Band-Aid, but we do it all the time. Don't just try to patch things up. You want to heal the wounds. You want to be able to move forward together. So instead of holding grudges, practice forgiveness by striving to understand your partner's intentions, right? Where is your spouse coming from? And extend that grace. God gives it to you. Remember, two imperfect beings brought together. And forgiveness, it allows you to cultivate deeper love and a connection. Go to Colossians 3, verse 13. Bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. Don't go to bed angry. I'm not saying don't go to bed angry when you guys are fighting, but about how you feel about your spouse. You need to resolve that internally. When you forgive, that doesn't mean you forget. But you let it go. You give it over to God and you say, Lord, you got to take this one. It's not for me to deal with. Jesus, take the wheel. Jesus, take it. You deal with this because I cannot. And you let him take care of it. And then you say, okay, I've got to practice forgiveness. What does that look like? And I'm telling you right now, it is not easy. It's hard to hold your tongue. It is. It's hard to sit there and say, gosh, he's done this like 500 times already this week. And that's probably not an exaggeration, right? It just happens. And also what you look for, you're going to find, by the way. So if you keep looking for the trouble areas of your spouse, you're going to find them and they're going to always stand out. So start looking for the good. That's bonus number four. Always look for the good in your spouse. Behind closed doors, the battles may rage, but the power of kindness and compassion can ignite a flame that conquers all storms and leads to marital bliss. Marriage, my friend, is a lifelong commitment, and it requires unwavering dedication and effort. It's not just, oh, we fell in love and it's just to be happily ever after. It would be nice to have the Cinderella story. But think about if, you know, even though that was a fairy tale, think about that story. It wasn't a fairy tale to the very, very end. She had to overcome challenges. And if they extended the Cinderella story, guaranteed there would have been other challenges to follow. So lead with kindness and compassion, right? And when you do, you as a couple, you can fight against the unseen battles and build a foundation of love, trust, forgiveness, and understanding. Are you empathizing? Are you mindfully communicating and listening to each other? And my friend, are you forgiving? Because when you do that, you can transform your home into a sanctuary of profound connection and intimacy that I'm telling you will be beyond anything you can imagine. So together, embrace the beauty and the power of marriage fueled by kindness and compassion. Go in peace, be present, be incredible. Be you. I love you so very much. I cannot wait to see you on the other side. Blessings, hugs, and lots of love. We'll talk to you real soon. Have a glorious, blessed day. Bye-bye.
Feeling inspired, ready to train for life, and love your journey? Visit createyournow.com for more incredible resources to help you along the way. We'll see you next time on Create Your Now, Your Best Selfie. And remember, always be sure you consult your physician before beginning any health and fitness plan.